from the book of Acts. After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth. There he found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had ordered all Jews to leave Rome. Paul went to see them, and because he was of the same trade, he stayed with them, and they worked together. By trade, they were tent makers. Every Sabbath, he would argue in the synagogue and would try to convince Jews and Greeks. After staying there for a considerable time, Paul said farewell to the believers and sailed for Syria, accompanied by Priscilla and Aquila. At Cenchrea, he had his hair cut, for he was under a vow. And when they reached Ephesus, he left them there. But first he himself went into the synagogue and had a discussion with the Jews. When they asked him to stay longer, he declined. But on taking leave of them, he said, "I will return to you if God wills." Then he set sail for Ephesus. Now there came to Ephesus a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria. He was an eloquent man, well versed in the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he spoke with burning enthusiasm and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus, though he knew only the baptism of Jesus. He began to speak boldly in the synagogue. But when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained the way of God to him more accurately. And when he wished to cross over to Achaia, the believers encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. On his arrival, he greatly helped those who through grace had become believers, for he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, showing by the scriptures that the Messiah is Jesus. And from the letter to the Romans, "I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a deacon of the church of Centuria, so that you may welcome her in the Lord as is fitting for the saints, and help her in whatever she may require from you, for she has been a benefactor of many and myself as well. Greet Prisca and Aquila, who work with me in Christ Jesus and who risk their necks for my life."
So this morning we continue our contemplation of the women after whom many of our name rooms in this church are named. 12 women in all. The first installment of this series, we looked at four women who kind of come under the general rubric of misfits. Dare I ask you to recall their names for me? Anybody? Okay, I heard Tamar, Ruth, yes, Rahav. One more, Bathsheba, excellent. Yeah, four women there. And then last week, we looked at three disciples. Anybody, can you name one name from the disciples? Mary, that's right. Covered all three, right? Three Marys. Mary, the mother of Jesus, who later was depicted as a disciple, as well as Mary Magdalene and Mary of Bethany. This morning, we'll consider two leaders of churches in the early church, Priscilla and Lydia. Afterwards, invite you to go to their rooms. They're arranged in alphabetical order. Lydia is at the end in the library, and then Priscilla, if you continue on, is where the choir rehearses. And you'll be able to meet these women and find out more information about them, and also collect a prayer bead. I have a prayer bead that represents each woman from our series, and we have a whole prayer bead making station in the hallway between the two rooms where you can pick up the beads from previous weeks if you missed those. So I invite you to do that as well. Next week, we'll have our women presence for our final installment in this series, but we will not have Marguerite Bennett with us because she will be in Anchorage, Alaska. So we'll have a chance to recognize everybody this next week, but not Marguerite. So Marguerite, thank you very much for your... Now, and my reflections, by the way, are integrated in what the women say this morning, so they're not a separate reflection. So let us hear from Priscilla.
Good morning. My name is Priscilla, or Prisca for short. Priscilla means ancient. Ancient may seem like a strange name for a parent to give their child. In the modern world, it's embarrassing to be called old, let alone ancient. Old people are like Rodney Dangerfield. They don't get no respect. Is that right? Okay. But in my day, old things were considered good things because they stood the test of time. My name, therefore, was like being called venerable or worthy of respect. Isn't it funny how times change? My husband Aquila and I were citizens of Rome and pagans before we converted to Christianity, which was simply called the Way back then. Not only did we convert to the Way, but we became prominent evangelists and church leaders. Why did we convert? I'm glad you asked. In order to understand, you have to know a bit about Roman paganism. In this religion, like others in the ancient world, there were lots of gods and goddesses running around upstairs. And they were constantly bickering and fighting and betraying each other. Gods are really like an enormous, messed up family, like we might find among humans. And when the gods come downstairs to interact with us now and then, they take their quarreling and fighting with them. Human beings are little more than helpless pawns in the power struggles of the gods. If you're lucky enough to meet up with a god who truly cares about you, you're actually the least lucky of all. Some other god is sure to become jealous and hurt you or destroy you just to hurt the god who favors you. The world of the gods is cold, cruel, and unfair. In other words, it's exactly like our world. In fact, you could say that the whole construct of Roman religion is meant to answer the perennial question of why there is so much pain and suffering in our world. The gods are responsible. If it weren't for the gods, we might stand a fighting chance of creating something better for ourselves. Passing human suffering off on the gods might sound primitive to you, but have things really changed so much? If you suffer a string of setbacks, one after the other, don't you shake your fists at the heavens sometimes or assume you've done something to upset God? The problem that my husband and I had with our religion is the same problem that we have with those who blame human suffering on God today. It just seems like a cop-out. It's a lot easier to blame an invisible divine being for suffering than other humans themselves. When we hear people ask today, how could God love us when there's so much pain and suffering in the world? That sounds like a pagan question in our ears. Just who do you think is responsible for things like warfare and poverty? Is it God or us? It may be easier to blame forces that are outside of our control, but that doesn't make it right. Promoting the idea that human suffering is to be blamed on the gods is a great strategy for anyone who has power and privilege and wants to keep it that way. They can say your suffering has nothing to do with my greed or my envy or my lust for power and control, so don't look too closely at what I'm doing. Look to the gods if you're looking for someone to blame. My husband and I didn't buy it. When we looked out at creation, for instance, it just didn't make sense that whatever power had placed us in the midst of all this beauty, this veritable Garden of Eden, would simultaneously stab us in the back by acting like the gods. In fact, it seemed to us that whoever created all this beauty must be amazingly generous to allow us to inhabit the earth, despite our violence, greed, and lack of appreciation for our blessings. Generous and patient and kind and forgiving. In other words, this god must be nothing like the gods of Rome. When my husband and I first heard of Jesus, we heard that he preached loving one's enemies over hating them. He taught about prodigal sons who were welcomed home by their father after squandering their inheritance. We heard about how Jesus preferred to spend time among prostitutes and tax collectors and sinners in order to heal them of their hurts, rather than spending time with those who considered themselves righteous and arrogantly thought they didn't need help. We wanted to know more about the God who inspired Jesus to teach and act this way.
Then we heard that Jesus was tortured and hung on a Roman cross just for preaching about a God of love and grace. And we heard that even from the cross, Jesus prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." We were shocked when we heard this. Who could be so generous-spirited that they would forgive even those who rejected them so viciously? Surely, if Jesus as God were responsible for growing his heart this large, we wanted to worship that God too. And that's when we experienced it. We experienced something like one of your more recent theologians, John Wesley, put it, a heart strangely warmed. It was like Jesus was alive in our hearts, and he's been there ever since. A little while after this experience, God sent us to Corinth, where we met the Apostle Paul. Paul was so kind and so gracious and so generous that we could tell that his heart had been strangely warmed by Jesus too. In fact, Paul's heart was on fire. He wanted nothing more than for this same fire to spread throughout the world. When we learned that he financed his mission to the world through tent making, we knew that God had sent him to us for a reason. Aquila and I were tent makers too. And frankly, we made better tents than Paul did, so we knew we could teach him a thing or two about tent making. We did. And Paul taught us more about Jesus and the Holy Spirit, which he said was the Spirit of Jesus that warms every heart who accepts him. Soon, we found ourselves traveling with Paul around the Mediterranean. Once or twice, we even risked our lives for this kind soul. You see, his preaching about a God of love and grace angered those who were heavily invested in people blaming the gods for their troubles rather than other human beings, especially them. Eventually, we journeyed with Paul to Ephesus, where he made us the leaders of the church that he established there. I'm humbled to say that the community we continue to build in Ephesus became one of the most renowned communities in the Christian world. Many Christian leaders arose from our congregation, leaders like Apollos, who we personally tutored. Paul was so appreciative of our efforts that Aquila and I are mentioned no less than 6 times in his letters. And 4 of those times, Paul mentions me before my husband. A lot of people wonder why Paul would break the common convention by naming me first. Some people wonder if it was because of Paul's belief that men and women are equal, and therefore either of us could be mentioned first. Others wonder if it was because I was a more prominent leader than my husband. I'll just leave you all to wonder about that for yourselves. But while you're wondering, I will finish by offering you a little something that I wonder about. I wonder why so many people in your day don't realize how many women served as leaders of Christian churches when the New Testament clearly mentions us. Do they not read their Bibles? Or do they hope you won't read yours?
Myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Though they may be parted, there is still a chance.
From the 16th chapter of Acts. Paul went also to Derbe and to Lystra, where there was a disciple named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was Greek. He was well spoken by the believers in Lystra and Iconium. Paul wanted Timothy to accompany him, and he took him and had him circumcised because of the Jews who were in those places, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they went from town to town, they delivered to them for observance the decisions that had been reached by the apostles and the elders who were in Jerusalem. So the churches were strengthened in faith and increased in numbers daily. They went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. And when they had come opposite Mysia, they attempted to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia, pleading with him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." And when he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We set sail for Troas, and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside to the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and we spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira, and a dealer of purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by God. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my house." And she prevailed upon us.
Hello. I'm another one of those church leaders who many people in your day still don't seem to know existed. Like Priscilla, I was a pagan before converting to the way. Only I wasn't a Roman. I was Lydia. I was from Lydia, hence my name. Today you'd call me Turkish. My hometown was Thyatira. You may remember Thyatira from your Seven Letters to Seven Churches series on the Book of Revelation. Thyatira was a working-class town, chock full of trade guilds. In fact, there were more trade guilds in Thyatira than any other city in the Mediterranean. Like modern-day trade guilds or unions, the guilds of Thyatira functioned as organizations that looked after the interests of the artisans and craftspeople of a particular trade. Yet our guilds did much more. They were kind of a cross between a professional association, a trade union, a cartel, a secret society, and a church. Of course, the guilds actually weren't churches, but they acted like them insofar as each guild served a particular god or goddess who was thought to be the patron saint of the guild. Our work and our religious life were inseparable. We believe that if you honored the god of your guild in a way that was pleasing, the god would bless you with success, perhaps even make you rich. My family became quite wealthy through our work, so we were extra enthusiastic worshipers of our God. Part of the reason we were wealthy was, however, was had to do with the kind of cloth that we manufactured instead of the God we served. Our fabrics were so soft and finely crafted that they were often purchased by kings, queens, and other royalty, which is why most of our cloth was dyed purple, the color of royalty. When I moved to Philippi in Greece, I continued to sell purple cloth there. Can you guess where and who I imported it from? Now, in the Bible, I am the first recorded convert to Christianity on European soil. You may wonder why I would swap the God of my guild, who was thought to be responsible for my success, for the God of Jesus. Well, I'm glad you asked. One day, the Apostle Paul and a couple of companions of his came to town. One of his companions was named Luke, the author of the Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts. I met Luke down by the river where I had gone to pray. He asked me who I was praying to, and I told him I was praying to the God of my guild. Then I stretched out my hands and prayed, "Oh God, you know how devoted to you I am. You know how I offer you sacrifices day and night. In return for my humble devotion, I ask that you bless me with abundant sales in the marketplace. I ask that you continue to prosper me and my family each and every day. I ask that you prosper us until we are the wealthiest, most successful merchants of purple cloth in all of Greece and Lydia. Through our success, your glory will be made known not only to us, but to the world. Amen." After I finished praying to my God, Luke began to pray to his. "Our Father," he prayed, "who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I ask for nothing but my bread for the day and for forgiveness of my sins to the extent that I forgive the sins of others. Do not let me be tempted by any greed or undue reward, but deliver me from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Our prayers could not have been any more different. I had prayed that my will be done. He prayed for his God's will to be done. I had prayed for the increase in prosperity of my realm. He prayed for the increase of God's realm. I had prayed for wealth and success. He asked nothing for himself but his bread for the day. For strength to avoid the day's temptations and for forgiveness. I was dumbfounded. Who is this God you are praying to? I asked. He told me he prayed to the God of Jesus, who was crucified and whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus and his God must be pretty powerful if he was raised from the dead, I said. Yes, my God created the universe, said Luke. If your God created everything, then why do you refer to your God as Father? Like God is your parent? God is my true parent, said Luke, and yours too. I could hardly believe what I was hearing. If his God was so powerful and was also his true parent, then he could have asked for all the wealth and power he ever could have wanted, and then some. But the only benefit he asked for was enough bread for the day. The rest of his prayer was about God's benefit and that of others. Luke and I continued to talk about Jesus and his God until I finally asked him, "Can you give me something?" "I'll give you whatever I can," he responded. "If it is possible, I would like you to give me a heart like yours. For I, who am among the wealthiest people in Philippi, asked my God for even more wealth, while you, who have far less, asked for little but the benefit of others. If I had a heart like yours, I would probably have less money, but I would be the richest woman in Philippi." Luke told me that he couldn't give me his heart, but that Jesus could give me his heart. He said that this was all it really takes to have Jesus' heart, to earnestly want it. So I asked. I asked with all my heart to receive Jesus' heart. Suddenly, I felt a strange warming in my heart. The warmer it got, the more it seemed to grow. From that time on, I opened my house to Luke, Paul, their companions, and anyone else who wanted a heart like Jesus. Eventually, my house became the first Christian church in Philippi. When Paul and Luke eventually left Philippi, I asked them if I should remain in my profession as a merchant of purple cloth or devote myself to the Christian ministry. Both of them insisted that I could and should do both. They told me to simply treat the recipients of my professional labors with the same respect and generosity I would offer Jesus if he were my customer, and to teach others to do the same. They promised that if I would do these things, there would not be just one minister of the way in Philippi, me, but as many ministers as my house could hold. This is exactly what I did. Soon we had all kinds of people treating the recipients of their labor as if they were Jesus himself. This brought more and more people into my house and learning how to receive the heart of Jesus. And if you want to know how it all turned out, just read Paul's letter to my church in Philippi. You know, the epistle to the Philippians. There you'll find out that treating others like you would treat Jesus not only grows your soul, but it grows your church, and it grows the best kind of church there is.
Trust it.
So this morning, during the children's message, Rebecca challenged us to consider what if God, you know, could you picture God as a mother? We speak a lot about God as Father, but we also know that God is beyond gender. Can we shift? Can we envision God as mother? Well, you may be interested to know that some of the great saints of the church, including a saint famous like Julian of Norwich, referred to Christ at times as mother. Perhaps we can envision Jesus himself in some way, especially as Christ, as mother, as we hear these words a little differently when we hear it from mother's mouth, our true mother's mouth. For we remember on a night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus, our mother, took bread and broke this bread, saying, "My friends, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this as often as you eat of it in remembrance of me." So likewise, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." By eating this bread and drinking this cup, we remember Christ's death. We celebrate Christ's resurrection. And we also come bite by bite, Sunday by Sunday, to inherit the heart of Jesus, the gifts of God for the people of God. I invite our servers to prepare the feast. And as they come forward, I invite you to join me in reminding ourselves of who we are and whose we are. We are an inclusive, open and affirming family of faith, welcoming all to God's table of love and acceptance. We are diverse, yet united by Christ's example. We care for one another, support one another, and challenge one another to become all that God creates us to be. We work together to nurture our community and to promote peace and justice in our conflicted world. You don't have to be a member of Countryside Community Church or subscribe to any particular doctrine or dogma to come forward to this table.